Let's play a quick game, you and I. I got two markers here. One's blue, one's red. Okay? And you are a lion. I am a lion. You're a lion. Okay? And you have an opportunity to be one of these lions. And one of these lions, they have free food. They got free shelter. They got free health care. They have free college education paid off. Let's just put them in a blue box. All right? And let's just say they're in this cage or this zoo. But they got all that stuff. But this other lion got free reign. He could be roaming the jungle. He's free. He's got a hunt. He's got a hunt to eat, but he's free. And let's just create a nice red sun here right quick. But anyway, I'm going to explain to you in this video how aspiring millionaires or current millionaires right now, how they should be thinking about how to vote in this episode of the Second Fury Squad happening right now in 3, 2, 1. Let's go. What's cracking, everybody? Money Smart Guy Matt Sapaula here, hailing to you from the Seven Figure Squad studio here in Oak Brook Terrace, Illinois. And by the way, before I continue, we've officially crossed 25,000 subs on this channel. It's just been amazing the last 30, 60 days. I think our metrics say, our analytics say that we've grown 7,000-8,000 subscribers in the last 28 days. So I want to say thank you. And I want to let you know that we're going to be doing a live video after this video is posted. We're going to be doing a live video because I have some giveaways. So make sure you stay posted to my channel. If you haven't done so already, please subscribe. Hit notification, be alerted the next time we do that episode. So therefore, you can win some giveaways. Three of you have already been picked as winners. And a couple others I want to self-select on that live video because I got some giveaways to hand out. So with that being said, guys, I'm excited about what's about to happen next Tuesday, November 3rd, Election Day. Probably one of the most chaotic elections you've probably had in modern history, probably in the history of America, but it's crazy election season coming up, election day coming up. And so I want to do a video from the perspective of millionaires. I want to do this video from the perspective of aspiring millionaires. I want to do this video for those of you that's watching this video because one day you want to be financially free. And so if you're on this video, you're watching this right now, and you're okay with making 30, you're okay with making 40, you're okay with making $50,000 for the rest of your life, and you just hope that somebody one day is going to take care of you, I just want to let you know, this is not the video for you. I'm sorry, but this is the Seven Figure Squad. This is a channel for those that want to be a millionaire. For those that say, man, I don't want to live paycheck to paycheck anymore. And some of you guys say, well, man, millionaire's a lot of money. Oftentimes people say, if I make six figures, I make $200,000. Listen, right now, if you make six figures in Northern California, in San Francisco, six figures is considered low income. In New York, if you're making $200,000 a year, that's considered average low income. So the way things are going the last 29 years is that things are costing more. Cost of goods and services are going up. But what hasn't gone up? Wages. Wages. So if you're watching this channel right now, it's because you want to be a millionaire one day. So listen, I've been getting all these comments on my reaction videos to 50 Cent, reaction videos to Ice Cube, reaction videos to what's going on right now with politics and how it affects our finances and our economy. And some comments are saying rich people are evil. We were just at Jekyll Island last week because we had a special declaration of values and principles, which was inspired to create that for our company. And we did that at Jekyll Island in Georgia. And I got all these comments of evil, rich people, evil people. Listen, guys, I want to let you guys know, I've not been rich my entire life. I wasn't raised with a silver spoon in my mouth. I was raised in an average and ordinary neighborhood here in the Chicagoland area called the Berwyn-Cicero Stickney area. I went to Morton High School. It's a public high school. I served 8 years in the Marine Corps. So before I made my money for the good part of my adult life, I was broke. I've been on the other side of money for a very long time. Thank God somebody taught me the rules of the money game. So if you think that rich people are evil, guess what? You'll never be rich. If you think that people with money is evil, you're wrong. But the Bible says, if you read scripture, it says the love of money, not understand how money works for you, but the love of money, you're right, that's evil. But money in itself is just simply a tool. A tool for what, Matt? Well, to get your life. To get your life back, for you to have time. My wife and I, we've built a business in the last 5.5 years. This play is close to $6 million. And guess what we have? We have time. We have time to do what we want. And so when you're looking at what's going on in our country right now, before I jump into my analysis here to how to help you vote to be an aspiring millionaire, if you're a current millionaire right now, you know, this conversation right now of capitalism, socialism, communism, it's kind of scary. I'll tell you this. It's kind of scary. Some beliefs of capitalism. Here's some of the beliefs. Here's some four things that you need for capitalism to work in our country. Free to buy, free to sell, free to try, and last but not least is free to fail. Which a lot of people, for some reason, is, I'll underline this in blue. For some reason, people are afraid to fail. Why are you afraid to fail? Failure is actually your friend. To an entrepreneur, to a capitalist, failure allows you to get better. Instead of getting bitter, you get better, not quit. So some of the operations is this. I have an analogy there. Well, Matt, what's the difference between capitalism and socialism? Well, listen, capitalism says you studied. You studied for your exam. You studied for your test. You were prepared. And when you get to school, you took the exam. You got the A. You worked hard for your promotion. And when it came time for promotion review, because not only did you have seniority, not did you only have experience, but hey, you were doing the job. And guess what? You got promoted. Capitalism. You're in sales. You did this. You hit your quota. You sold your clients. You're doing what you're supposed to do as a salesperson, as an entrepreneur. Guess what? You get the reward. You hunted. You get to eat your prey. Yours. Not somebody else's. Yours. And so some of the examples of capitalism, obviously the United States of America. Some of the examples is Hong Kong. I think Hong Kong is considered one of the best free markets in the world. Other countries that are starting to turn around because of capitalism. Believe it or not, there's some of the biggest population type countries in the world, like China and India. As soon as they start incorporating capitalism into their country, guess what happened? Started the country's wealth, started exploding, they started competing. But the bottom line is this, capitalism has allowed people to have free enterprise, free to buy, free to sell, free to try, and free to fail. Here's one of the biggest mistakes I think that is the biggest mistake for a lot of people is that when the banks were failing during the Great Recession, 08, 09, what did the government do? What did President Obama do? Bailout. And these banks that were too big to fail, guess what? They got financially bailed out. What about you and I? We didn't get bailed out. What about you and I? They were single moms, single dads. We didn't get bailed out. Average American didn't get bailed out. Where's our bailout? They ain't going to bail us out. They bailed out the banks. They bailed out the stock market. They didn't bail us out. And here's a problem. Now, everybody thinks they're waiting. Hey, since you bailed out these companies, where's my bailout money? You ain't getting one. See, that's a problem. It created entitlement into America. People think they deserve something. When you read the Constitution, when you read the Declaration of Independence, right, we the people, when you read the Declaration of Independence, right, it's for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It's not the pursuit of your bailout when you fail. Back to this analogy here. Socialism. Some of the beliefs are I'm entitled to certain entitlements. I'm a citizen, I pay my taxes, I'm entitled to food, health care, I'm entitled to tuition, education, I'm entitled to certain things. It's entitlement that you deserve something. Operation here is look at Venezuela. Look at the examples of Venezuela and Cuba. Venezuela has got one of the largest oil resources in the world, but due to corruption and understanding how that socialistic society works, that the government is controlling a lot of things, guess what happens to that resource? It gets floundered. What happened to people in Venezuela? You go to Venezuela, you go to a grocery store, no food to buy. People, you see the picture. We have a percentage of our company, our current company right now, we have 16,000 licensed agents. We have a percentage of growing population within inside a company of Venezuelans actually coming to us, coming to the insurance industry. They're based out of Orlando. They're based out of Florida because that's where they're coming into. But we have a population of people from Venezuela coming in because they're fleeing socialism. So let's look at this analogy. Somebody asked me real quick, Matt, how do you quickly and simply explain capitalism versus socialism? I was asked this a couple years ago, and here's my explanation very quickly. It was simply over coffee. It was simply over a conversation at a hotel with a bunch of younger entrepreneurs. They asked, what's the difference? So let's take a look at this right quick.
How do you explain capitalism in a
very simplistic way? The same way I explained it to my 16-year-old and now 17-year-old daughters. So for example, we go to school, we're studying for a test. You get an A, I didn't study, I get an F. Teacher says, well, we gotta be socialistic, not capitalistic. You study for your test, but little Matt didn't. So we gotta reduce your A to a C. We gotta raise my F to a C. Second time we go around. You say, you know what, maybe I don't study for my test. You get a C this time. I still get my what? F. So they lower your C to a D. They raise my F to a D. Okay? Third time into socialistic capitalism, you're like, forget this, F. Third time in it, everybody's failing. Like in Venezuela.
So how would you like to be that student? that study for an A, but based on everybody else, you got to lower your A to a B. How would you feel if you were that type of student? So it removes the capacity for somebody to really want to try and say, I got ownership of my success because I got to share with everybody else. How would you feel if you got a $10,000, matter of fact, how would you feel if you got your tax refund and the government said, hey, we believe in sharing the wealth. We believe in sharing with everybody in our neighborhood. Or the IRS said, hey, listen, based on the people in your neighborhood, a lot of them aren't making ends meet, so we're going to split up your $3,000 tax refund. You're going to get $100 yourself, but I'm going to split up with 29 of the other neighbors to get $100 themselves. How would you feel? Well, that's what you're considering on voting for here come November 3rd. Some examples here of communism. You know, lots of times people say that Karl Marx had a strategy of socialism. Let me write this again in blue. A socialism that goes down a slippery slope and ends up into communism because you end up giving up control. You end up giving up ownership. Here, capitalism, ownership, deeds, titles. Here, you defer that to somebody else. You give up that ownership for somebody else to provide it to you. And what are some of the examples? Some countries, Soviet Union, North Korea. You think people are happy in the Soviet Union? What happened to the Soviet Union? It broke up. You think people are happy in North Korea? You know, I was stationed in Okinawa, Japan. I took a trip down to South Korea. And it's amazing here. Let me share you this night picture of the difference between North Korea and South Korea at night. You'll be shocked at what you see at night when you look over the board, the parallel here between the parallel separating North Korea and South Korea. You see, north of the parallel, it's dead, it's cold, it's dark. South of the parallel, capitalism, boom, light and life. People are happier. And so if you're looking at what president, candidate is going to be voting in policies, incorporating policies, look at what Trump has done. Look at Bernie and AOC, look what they're about to incorporate if you get them voted in. Some very dangerous things here are going to happen to you. And by the way, you've got to process this. And by the way, I want to tell you right now, I'm not telling you with this video who to vote for. How am I going to do that? Let's take a look at this. Here's a way for you to process who deserves your vote. Here's a way for you to process. So, for example, number one, you got to list the issues that are most important to you. You got to figure out the platform that they stand on. So, for example, there's a bunch of them, by the way. Here's just six, seven of them. I'll just list. Number one is economy. Number two, by the way, in no particular order. Economy, taxes, foreign affairs, gun control, immigration, healthcare, education. Some of you might say social injustice, abortion, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Right? So write down your list. Write down your list. Human rights, write down your list. By the way, I only have so much room on this board. But write down, my list isn't your list. And your list isn't somebody else's list. It's your list. You have the vote. You have the capacity to vote certain things in. Okay, so you write them now. You list the things. You list your issues you care about. The things that you feel will affect your house. And again, in no particular order. Matter of fact, in no particular color of pen. So no particular order. You're saying, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is in terms of a priority. Like number one is a very important issue to me. Number two is a very important issue to me. Matter of fact, one of the things here, outside of a social injustice / human rights, you might want to put in abortion, right? Some may say a global warming. Whatever those issues are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10. Some of you guys may even say the coronavirus and how the government is handling the coronavirus and the shutdowns. I'll tell you right now, here in this blue state of Illinois, the restaurants are shut down again. California, the difference between, think about this real quick, the difference between Disney World in Orlando versus Disneyland in Anaheim, California, same company, same CEO, two different outcomes with Disneyland and Disney World in two different states. One's red, one's blue, based on their regulations and laws they're putting forth in that state. So here are your issues. Rate them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So now, number three, research. Now, here's a funny fact about research. We pulled this report up on journalism.org. My question is, where do you get your news? More specific, where do you get your political views from? Well, according to this report here, that people between ages 18 to 29 years old, 48% of those between 18 and 29 years old get their information from social media. Here's where I have a problem with getting your research, 48% solely from social media. Here's the problem. On Netflix, they showed this documentary called The Social Dilemma. And the guys from Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, et cetera, all the folks that engineered and developed these social apps not only created a great benefit for everybody, but also a very big danger, because now you're the product. What am I talking about? They got your data. They got your clicks. They got your likes. They know who you're talking to. They know what you're talking about. They know who you're commenting on. They know what videos you watch. And guess what they do? Based on that social dilemma, guess what they found out? Guess what they admitted to? They're saying if all you're watching is liberal content, liberal content, liberal content, conservative content, conservative content, conservative content, guess what they're only going to be showing you? That. So in other words, you're getting flooded with that the sky is falling, or white supremacy, or social injustice, or abortion, or gun control, because you keep clicking on this stuff, and guess what they're doing? They're sending you that stuff because you keep asking for it by your clicks and your comments. That's not fair. That's not independent journalism. That's not being independent, period. That's being biased to one way of thinking. Well, 48% of you all that are between 18 and 29 years old have your political views viewed by social media. So when you're talking about your research, social media could be one of them, but it should not be the only one. Now I'm going to give you a throwback. Do you read newspapers? Do you read magazines? Do you find non-biased information? Do you find recommendations for people who have a little bit more wisdom than you do? Do you have recommendations for people that are a little older than you that have been through life a little bit for issues that pertain to you when having a family, when having a career, when having financial security or opportunity? Do you talk to people older than you about how they voted with Obama, how they voted with Bush, how they voted with Bush before, how they voted with Clinton, how they voted for Reagan, etc., etc.? Carter, Nixon, did you ask them how they voted and why they voted? See, that's getting recommendations. So ask yourself these particular areas. Did you do your research on this? How many sources? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Did you really get 10 different sources, non-biased recommendations to help you educate yourself about that particular issue? Yes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. By the way, I'm just saying 5. Whatever number that you decide to. It could be 3. It could be 12. It could be 20. But jot down here. So when you're looking at this stuff, right? When you're looking at your list, you look down, okay, I've researched this, I've researched that, I researched this, I listened for this person, I interviewed this type of person, I became less biased. Guess what starts to happen to you? You start thinking more independently based on the values and principles that you hold as a priority. Number 4, then you go and find who aligns with what you value as a priority. You find, now, I'll switch back to the markers. Now, does Trump align with your values, with the policies that they're going to be incorporating in America, signing his bill, signing his law? Do they align with what you believe to be evident, to be your self-evident, to be your truth, to be your priority based on where you're at right now in your life and in the future? But here's the issue. The more you do this, I'm just putting out there these issues. I'm not saying that these guys have the best policy per this issue or this guideline. All I'm saying is this. The more you spread out to allow yourself to map out how you're thinking and how you're receiving information, how you're formulating your political views, and how you formulate the way you think about policy. And oftentimes, I don't like the personality, man. I don't like the personality. I get, you know, like certain personalities. I get the fact that some of you don't like Sleepy Joe. I get the fact that some of you guys don't like Kamala. I get that some of you guys don't like Mr. Orange Man, President Trump. But you got to get past personality. Well, some of you say, man, I can't see past character. I get it. But how many of you actually work for a boss? You didn't like the character. You like the personality. You sucked it up anyway. You still took the job. You still took the salary. Where's the hypocrisy there now? So if you're looking at the situation, here's what I love about America, is that there's many different branches of government that end up self-policing. One can't be a tyrant. That's not the way the country is designed, because there's certain checks and balances to get people in or out. So when you're looking at policies versus personality, for me, personally for me, you may not agree with me, it's okay, but I lean more towards policy versus personality. Because I want to know what they sign into law for me to flourish, for me to have an economy, for me to have job creation, for me to have financial security, for me to benefit the people I love and care about, for me to make this a great country, or make it a greater country. And so when you're looking at the differences of the candidates, some of you guys said, well, I like this candidate based on this issue, but I don't like him on this issue. Now you got to ask yourself this. Am I willing to bend a little bit, because there's no such thing as a perfect candidate? Am I willing to bend a little bit on this issue? Am I willing to prioritize one issue over the other for the next 3-4 years? Are you? And more importantly, if you're just saying, I'm just going to vote. Now, more importantly, are you going to get involved in your local government? Are you going to get more involved in the young Democrats or the young Republicans? Are you going to get involved in fundraising for a local politician that may help create more laws and create more opportunity for whatever issue you feel strongly about? That's where you really then put in the work. You just can't say one time vote, okay, that's it, I don't get my way, wah, and cry. No, if you really feel strongly about your vote, then you should be getting involved. I'll tell you this, I'll be self-admitting here, that for many, many years, I could give a crap about politics. You know why? Because I wasn't making any money. But the moment I told myself, listen, I want to be financially free one day, and I did the math, there's a certain amount I have to make in order for my family of 5 children that we need to make to buy the house in a neighborhood we want to live in, to put our kids in school districts that we want them to get an education in. There's vacations we want to take. There's places we want to travel to and fly to and experience ourselves. Instead of just reading about history, we wanted to experience history. But that costs money. Some of you want to put your kids through AAU teams. Some of you, you want to have them compete at debate clubs and chess clubs. That costs money. Some of you want them to have doors wide open to them that you didn't have yourself. Well, guess what? That costs money. And unless you inherited money, guess what you have to be then? A first-generation cash flow millionaire or aspiring millionaire, at least above the $400,000 that is being proposed out there by Biden to tax more people over $400,000. Because in all fairness, when we did our numbers, you know what we discovered? For us to live the life we want to live, to be financially independent and have a retirement set aside where we retire mom and dad or retire mom and dad on both sides of the family, we needed to make $750,000. It can't be, and here's a cool thing about capitalism. We're free to find out how. And then when we figure out how, then we do. And guess what? When we do, because of capitalism, is private enterprise, guess what? We can now reap the fruit of our labor. And when we're looking at aligning here, sacrifice based on ratings, you have to find also, now circle the candidate that most aligns with your beliefs. That aligns with the things that you hold as a priority, whatever that is. And based on 3 out of 4, 4 out of 5, 7 out of 10, whatever that's going to be for you, well, guess what then? That's who you vote for. I will say this. There's not ever going to be a perfect candidate. There's never, ever going to be somebody that's perfectly going to be aligning with your economic beliefs, with your spiritual beliefs, with your social beliefs. Nobody's going to align with 100% of what you feel is valuable and is a priority in life and people around you. Not one. But you got to find somebody that aligns in things that you believe in, that you say, okay, I'm going to like you with these areas, but okay, I got you, man. Okay, do your job. Deliver what you promise. You got my vote. And that's how you vote like a millionaire. And that's how you vote like an aspiring millionaire. Because here's what I realized. Well, Matt, you suck. I don't agree with the boom. Hey, stop with the emotions. Please stop with the emotions. Here's why. When emotions are high, logic is low. You don't think clearly. You get very emotional. We got to find a way to live together. This is our country. This is our backyard. The laughing stock right now of the world, because we can't get our stuff together. And by the way, people from across the world want to come to America because they have an American dream. You know, our family's from the Philippines. You know what I've never heard from the Philippines? You know, Matt, we have a Filipino dream. I've never heard that before. But you know what I heard a lot of times? Matt, we have an American dream. And for those of you voting to allow your American dream come true, please do not get emotional about this. Please be a little bit more logical. If this helps you out, please let me know. Drop in the comment section. But what did you learn through this process? What did you learn so far? And as I wrap up, ask yourself, number one, what type of life do you want to live? Who do you want to be? Do you really want to be a millionaire? Are you a current millionaire? Do you want your millions to last and become deca-millions? So therefore, one day you could potentially become a billionaire? So therefore, you can give a lot more money? You can be a lot more of a bigger blessing to a lot of other people? See, listen, rich people aren't greedy. Listen, I've been broke a good majority of my life. You know, I realized I started hanging around rich people. Actually, a lot of rich people are caring. A lot of rich people are generous. A lot of rich people are very philanthropic. They want to give. They want to support. They want to give advice. But here's the crazy part. Nobody's asking them questions. Everybody's demanding from them as if they owe you something. Nobody owes you nothing. If you got air in your lungs and you have an opportunity to be here in America and you can walk above ground, you should be thankful and grateful. Nobody owes you anything. The moment you say, somebody owes me something, I'm a victim, I'm entitled, guess what starts happening to you? The mindset of freedom and independence starts slipping away. And then you allow somebody else to control your life because you think somebody else owes you something. Listen, the way I've been happy and fulfilled and excited and fired up about my days as an entrepreneur is that I'm free. That the hands right here in front of me are the ones in control of my financial future. Now, obviously, the God above allows me to be here to create opportunity, to see opportunity. He creates the opportunities. I just go and take it. But these hands, I pray like it's up to God, but I work like it's up to me. And for some reason, opportunities and doors just start opening. Number two, is my vote based on emotion or logic? Are you becoming more logical through this process, or are you still in an emotional state? Number three, what do you believe in? What do you believe in? At the end of the day, what do you believe in? And with that being said, guys, I hope that what you believe in here come November 3rd, and you get in that voting booth, and you vote Trump or Biden, Republican or Democrat. I hope these things go through your mind so you start manifesting the right vote that you feel is right for you. And I'm reminded of some wisdom that somebody dropped me one day. It says, Matt, give a man a fish. Give him what they feel they're entitled to. Give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. But you teach him how to fish. Teach him how to fish. Buy, sell, try, fail. You teach him how to fish. What's wrong? Success, failure. Boom, this is how you do it now. This is automatic. You teach him how to fish, that man or woman will eat forever. Because if a government is big enough to give you everything that you want, it's the same type of government that can take away everything that you've worked hard to have. Think about that. And before I let you go, the couple things I want you to check out. Number one, read this book here called Atlas Shrugged. It's a big book. If you have the time to get the movie, I think it's a four-part DVD series. But you might be able to find it on Amazon Prime. But this book 100% changed my life, changed my mind about capitalism and making sure that we keep our talent instead of losing them. It was written by Ayn Rand, a very famous economist back in the day. But Atlas Shrugged is a book that changed my perspective and how government and how entrepreneurs and how innovation and laws either build us or tear us down. Atlas Shrugged, check out this book. I believe it's Mark Cuban's favorite book, by the way. And a video I want you to consider watching too, as well as three signs that you need a career change. Because listen, if you've been laid off again, furloughed again, your business shut down because of the shutdowns of coronavirus, listen, I don't suspect that they have any news good for you. So maybe this might be their breaking point. This is probably the time of highest emotion for you. Instead of taking that anger, resentment, frustration, channel that into a positive direction. So watch this video, three signs that you're ready for a career change. And the other video I want you to check out too as well is how millionaires get what they want, but faster. Drop your thoughts in the comment section below. I'd love to know your feedback. I'd love to know what you're thinking. Were you thinking right? Now you're voting left. Were you left? Now you're thinking voting right. I want to know. Put in the comment section below. You think I'm a jerk? You think I'm an a-hole? You think I'm evil? Drop in the comment section below. I want to know. I appreciate you guys paying attention to this video and give me some time to help you digest and how to vote like a millionaire. If you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like. So therefore, you follow our business page, Money Smart Guy. And if you're watching this on YouTube, thank you for following us on YouTube. If you've already crossed 25,000 subs, make sure you click subscribe. Hit notification to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. Our next goal. It's to getting to 50,000 subs. When do you think we're gonna get to 50,000 subs? We were projected hit 25,000 subs when? A year and some change. Guys, we got here in the last 60 days. But when do you think we're gonna get to 50,000 subs? I wanna know. This channel continues to grow because of your viewership, because of your encouragement and interaction. And I appreciate you guys for helping build the community of the Seven Figure Squad for people who wanna think like a millionaire, that wanna strategize like a millionaire, so therefore they can become a first generation cash flow millionaire. That being said, I'm your Money Smart Guy, and until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today. Go vote!